Dawg is first up to bat. No batteries included and no strings attached. No holds barred, no time for move faking. Gots to get to loose so I can bring home the bacon. Brothers front, they say the drop can't flow, but we've been known to do the impossible like Broadway Joe. So sleep if you want, like who will help you get your Z's true. But here's the real scoop, I'm all that and then some. Short, dark and handsome, bust a nut inside your eye to show you where I come from. I'm vexed, fuming, I've had it up to here. My days of pain, dues are over, acknowledge me is in there. Yeah! Head for the border, go get a taco. I see record from the jump street, meaning from the get-go. Sit back, relax, and let yourself go. No sweat, but you're...
Attack skills and vocabulary too. Cover hits in the distant edition, it's all brand new. You're through, I'm interplanetary and like Doctor Who. So who?
Fuck your beef, no relief. I step on stage, girls scream like I'm Keith.
So we did it again. Less than 4 days. Well, it'll be about 4 days for everybody who get it. Ringtime Pro Wrestling back at it again. Keith is in the building. I found Keisha.
Yeah, I was hiding under a rock. Hiding under a big rock. A huge one. With a nice space. And an air mattress. I'm just saying. It was nice for a minute. But I had to come out of the rock. They told me I had to come from hiding.
So today is going to be an interesting day. We got a nice show for you lined up. A little bit be all over the place. But we go talk about this wrestling because that's what we come here to do. Today's episode, you're gonna notice is a little different. You might not the opening promo. You go hear some music. Yesterday, the great Phife Dawg of a Tribe Called Quest passed away. Anybody who knows me knows that I really love Tribe Called Quest. Gotta be my favorite rap group of all time. Midnight Marauders is at least my top three, if not my favorite album of all time. A lot of this show is about nostalgia, remembering our youth, remembering what made us who we are today. And as much as wrestling is a big part of that for me, hip hop music is a part of that for me. And for me, there's no hip hop without Tribe, man. They was the first group that kind of, when I say I self-identified with, like they was from the hood, but they weren't about being from the hood, if that makes any sense. You know what I mean? Like, it was about, how about this? Rap usually have one or two lanes, right? You got the extreme gangster, then you had the hammer, poppy pop, you know what I mean? And I didn't really relate to that. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Like, I ain't no thug. But I wasn't quite Fresh Prince either. Tribe, about where the lane I fell into, right? Especially Phife. Phife was like one of my favorite guys. He had a lot of pop culture references. He had a lot of sports references. Ill guy, really was into sports. And, God will be missed, man. I know he had been battling diabetes for a long time. 45 is just too young to go.
It is.
But yeah, so we're gonna bump a lot of Tribe throughout the show. The bumper music, the background music, all that. We're gonna have some fun. And you know what I'm saying? And even Phife had a wrestler reference. My style is everyday, all day, similar to Water Crushin MCs. My name is Sargent Slaughter. R.I.P. homie. You ready to do this, Keish?
I'm ready.
Alright. Man, look. So, pretty much this is all full bore road to WrestleMania, right? My question is, are you ready?
Man, Keith. Seriously? Like, seriously? Of course I'm ready.
I'm not. Oh. But, I don't think the WWE is ready. This is what I'll say. Preface this. I think this has the potential to be one of the greatest WrestleManias of all time or one of the worst. It's going to be one of the two. Don't think it's going to fall in the middle. Right? I think the card is not as exciting as it should be, per se. But I think with the lowered expectations, it can really pop off, right?
Right.
Also, I believe that this is an opportunity. It's an opportunity for a lot of people to get over and for it to set up big for, you gotta understand, there's three, four huge names that are coming back sometime after WrestleMania at some point. Seth Rollins gotta come back. Now, he might be ready, but I'm sure he's not gonna come back till like maybe the night after. John Cena, same thing. Might probably, best we're looking at night after, right?
Right.
Cesaro. Randy Orton. I mean, that's, that those four injuries right now could totally alter the card. But the bright spot is, with the people in place, if done right, because you only anticipate losing Wade Barrett from the main roster, right? So if you get what's going on now, well, Luke Harper, well, we'll get to that later. We anticipate losing Wade Barrett, which probably ain't been that utilized anyway. With the current climate of things that's going on now, you insert those four guys back in the mix, I think you got a lot of energy. You got a lot of lightning that could be used, right?
Right.
Flip that over, and then the NXT call-ups are going to come. Finn Balor, I would presume, after WrestleMania, is coming to the main roster. And if all speculation is correct, Doc Gallows and Carl Anderson, the Bullet Club, will be there as his backup. So, just understand, that's lightning in a bottle. Flip that over, Samoa Joe got to come to the main roster. That's another bullet in the chamber. So, I mean, NXT will be solid on its own. I'm not really worried about that. Bayley's probably coming to the main roster. That's another shot to the Divas division. The best thing I could hope for is that they create some kind of brand extension. I can give you a scenario where it immediately takes place right after WrestleMania. We'll probably go into that later into the show because, you know, why not? Why use all the good juice right now, right? So, Keisha, open impressions of Raw. Give me what you got.
A little shocking, but not necessarily too out of place. Definitely was impressed by the Roman Stephanie thing. I definitely have to say that it is what you want to see going into WrestleMania. It's definitely something that I was impressed by. I definitely like the fact that going throughout the show, that it didn't go into the normal direction of, oh, I'm Stephanie McMahon and I'm going to come out and I'm going to do something about it. You know, like, it didn't over escalate, I want to say. Like, it just didn't get to a point where she ends up doing something to him, you know, like the normal authority thing. Well, I'm in charge, so I'm going to throw you in this like ridiculously put together match with like 3-6 other wrestlers, and we're just going to watch you get beat up all night. Like, I'm just glad that didn't happen, you know. Instead, it was a whole nother direction that I enjoyed. Personal opinion, of course, but I definitely, I have to say this. Stephanie is like, she is one of my diva inspirations for a heel. Like, I have to say that I love to hate Stephanie. Like, it's just completely awesome. I mean, on every level. So, when she got out there and she got on that mic, I was definitely in a place where I was like, oh my God, Stephanie, I love you, but I can't stand you. Like, it's, she definitely gives room to, she definitely gives the, what's the words I'm looking for? The heel mentality that every female should aspire to be on some level. Definitely loving it. So I was impressed with the opening segments. Like, I definitely was glad. This is one of the times where I was glad that that's how Raw opened up.
Yeah, kind of funny. I had different feelings about it. I'll say this. Like you, I'm glad it didn't go to, hey, well, you go have a match with the League of Nations or something like that tonight, right? Like, I think we're beyond that. You can't punish him with nothing like that. And honestly, the only thing you got to do is wait till WrestleMania. His focus is to be lasered in on Triple H. Now, I think they could have used a week of them not even, like, Roman not even being on the show, right? Like, I would have liked training vignettes of Triple H just working out, getting himself together, and Roman somewhere, you know, running through the fields, trying to get ready. Like, I think that's so underused, right? But they're using it for the Shane Undertaker match, which is totally a lot. I love the Hell in a Cell video packages.
Definitely. Oh,
they're I think to understand this match, you got to understand two major elements. One, and I love the Shane video training packages where they show him training with the Gracies and him learning grappling and him learning submission holds. Because here's the thing. You got to give some kind of plausibility to Shane, right?
Right.
So, first thing, hey, he might be the biggest dog in the fight, but if he could lock one of them submission holds in, he have something, right? And he might not beat Taker, but he could wear him down. Also, play up the fact, Shane McMahon is a kamikaze pilot, right? He gives nothing about his body. He will give it up in a minute. Now, I don't know how that's going to play in his mid-40s. Now, that right there is something to be desired. I don't know how that's going to play in his mid-40s. 6 years, not really doing this. The only thing you got is that he's fully healed. You know what I mean? But on the flip side of it, other than that, I don't know. Like, I don't know what to think of it. But Keish, just go throw it out there. Would be surprised if Shane won the match, which is, I was not there 2 months ago, right?
Right.
I like that when they had the Kevin Owens AJ Styles match. I hate seeing it because when I see it, I keep thinking, "Oh, that's the match we should be having," right?
Right.
That's the feud we should be having. But I do understand this. We have to resolve the Kevin Owens Sami Zayn thing, and we do need Kevin Owens to kind of kick Sami Zayn off into the main roster before we can explore anything else.
I get that. I get that perfectly. But could there have possibly been another way to do that and take a whole nother direction with this without ruining any possibility of an AJ Styles Kevin Owens feud? Like, because at this point, I say that because at this point, you see them wrestle so much with each other that when if it were to happen in the future, you'd be like, oh, this again. You know, like, I don't want that to happen. I just don't want that to be a point where I see this match so many times that I'm not going to want to see it anymore. You know,
well, you're actually not going to see it anymore. Here's the thing. You saw it for 2 weeks. It's just a teaser. You're not going to see it anymore. Because here's the thing. Owens got to get ready for WrestleMania now. His match is set. And his match consists of six other people, one of them being Sami Zayn.
Right.
Which could be match of the night. Seven-man ladder match, which was where Daniel Bryan won his WrestleMania match at WrestleMania 31. Do you realize that that's just a year ago?
Yeah.
Do you realize what a year in wrestling is, man? I know I say that all the time on this show, but do you realize what a year in wrestling is? Like, it seemed like that was 5 years ago. Because, I mean, I guess since he had wrestled since, it was like, oh, wow, okay. Dog, Bryan won the belt in that same match. I like the idea of throwing that belt up there. I like the idea. I think the plot will still end with Sami Zayn probably winning the belt.
Right.
Sami Zayn and Owens will have their feud over the belt after that. AJ will finish this thing with Jericho, which is really dried, contrived. and then he'll go on to something else. Now, do him and Owens still end on a collision course? Probably so, right? Once again, why we need a brand extension? Because you can book this on out to a point of it could be for a world title on a secondary brand like SmackDown. But neither here nor there right now. You're not going to see that match again for a while. Best believe that. Mm-hmm. But I think there's other spots and places. And now, with those six guys in the match for the IC title, you created a division now where, like, these are your six viable competitors. I would play it up. Now, Zack Ryder probably is not going to be around. He's just kind of filler. But good job. We got Zack Ryder in WrestleMania.
Woo. Right.
Stardust, I don't know what to make of Stardust. Sin Cara, don't really know what to make of Sin Cara, even though it'd be nice for him to end up in a feud for the IC title, considering Kalisto's a U.S. champion, and you can isolate that over to the left, right?
Right.
So now, they don't have competing agendas, and you don't oversaturate with your luchas, right? Now, you can go in. Sami Zayn, Dolph Ziggler, you know, these are your money people for the IC title. Miz is there, just a filler. Miz is a credible enough guy for those guys to beat, and the win means something, if that makes sense.
It makes perfect sense.
Also, if he wants to drag somebody down and preoccupy somebody, he could start a little quasi feud and bother people, so you can, you know, you can rotate people with the champ,
right?
And then the other person got it. You gotta get rid of this annoying Miz thing before you get back here trying to pursue this belt. But I think it's a very interesting thing. I like how they set it up. I have three contenders come down after the match. They want their title shot. All had compelling cases. Kevin Owens trolled him. Said, hey, man, it should be a triple threat for the number one contender. He set up a triple threat with his guys. Then the other guys came, wrecked it. And then Stephanie, who was pissed, and she made a match. Now, also, I like what his dynamic with Stephanie. That sets up a face turn later on down the line. Like,
yeah.
Hey, the authority. You know what I mean? But... And the thing is, too, it may not be a face turn. Who knows? Because he did mention, hey, man, I'm Triple H boy. I shouldn't be going through this.
Well, you know, there always could be that interruption of Triple H being like, you ain't my boy. You know, and all it takes is one simple, like, whatever, and that's it. Like, that's it. So it's always a possibility that there could be a swerve in there somewhere. Like, yeah, you know, all of a sudden he goes to Triple H and is like, hey, man, you know, I'm your boy. And Triple H looking at him like, dude, who? Nah, not you. Don't know where you got that from. Bye. And that's it. So I have to say, you know, It means something, but it could possibly mean nothing. And I don't know about that. Always got to give another possibility.
Interesting setup so far, though. I can't complain. As I go through Raw, Dean Ambrose getting all the endorsements from the whole Hardcore Legends.
Yes. Yes.
Terry Funk showed up. Well, a mix of Terry Funk and Chainsaw Charlie were the same person. And he gave Dean Ambrose the chainsaw.
Which was awesome.
Which, the only person who could look crazier than Terry Funk with a chainsaw is Dean Ambrose. Here's the thing. I think this is the perfect launcher pad for Dean Ambrose. Dean doesn't even have to win this match. But he has to be dangerous enough and put Brock in enough danger where at the end of it, you like, that shut up bitch was crazy.
Yeah.
Like, this could be Mick Foley's Hell in a Cell. Now, this is kind of a flip because, hey, man, I usually don't encourage this. I think this could take some time off of Dean Ambrose's career at the end of it, because he's going to get beaten, right?
Right.
But it's a sacrificial lamb kind of thing. Now, he could very well win the match. Why? Because, hey, Brock is temporary. Brock is going to go away for a little while after this, probably until SummerSlam. And you can legitimize that Brock Lesnar lost if he got hit with a bat. I'm just saying, if he get hit with a crowbar too many times, there's a very legitimate reason why he lost.
Yeah, that's
took too
true.
Many chair shots. He got hit with a ladder. You know, I don't know if they go. The thumbtack bump is. You want to talk about one of the worst bumps I think there are in wrestling? I am not a fan of the thumbtack bump. Like, I'm like, no, we don't need it. I don't know why we doing this. It always backfires. And, man, I ain't about to sit here with a back full of thumbtacks for nobody.
It's just painful. Like, it's painful looking, and I'm pretty sure it's painful feeling. I don't like a thumbtack in my finger. So I know a whole back full of them? Nah. Think I'm good. I think everybody's like, no, I'm good. We can definitely cut that one out. Thank you. Just no. Mm-mm. I don't like any kind of variation of the thumbtack bump. I don't like thumbtacks. I don't like nails. I don't like none of that. No. No. Glass, nothing. Just no. No. Anything that can puncture the skin in the back, just nah. Mm-mm. Nope. Mm-mm. I'm not here for it. Sorry. Like, just, I can't. Mm-mm. Like, have you ever stepped on a thumbtack? Like,
yeah. That's why mm-mm. I hit the thumbtack bump. Like, I've stepped on one before.
Like,
you good? You good? They be like, yo, we just. I'm going to tell you right now, I'd be the safest wrestler in the world. They'd be like, hey, so Keith, we got this idea for you. Nah, not doing it.
Right.
They'd be like, nah, man, but this could really further your career. You could really go to the next level. Nah, not doing it. What about diving off it? Nah, nah. What about an arm drag? What about a good old arm bar?
No, Keith. Just no.
No. A body slam? Okay. Where? And how long? You know what I mean? Like, I need details.
Look, okay, I'm sorry, but considering your height, like, no. Like, I would need you to take, like, a suplex off the top rope or something. Like, you can't do.
No, consider my height makes it way more dangerous. No, scrap that. I'm not taking it. Man, look, you know how high I gotta go? No, bro. No.
Okay.
That's a long way down to land on your back. Hell no.
See, what's funny is, I hate, it's funny because, like, I am not the one to sit here and be like, yeah, I want to be suplexed. I'm not saying that I this is my particularly preference of what I want to happen, but I think that if I'm a wrestler, you know, it just kind of comes with the territory. Now, I wouldn't agree with you throwing me through a table that's lit on fire, but you know, I could take a chair shot or two. I'm cool. How much check?
Nope. I don't see how Triple H would. Let me tell you something. If let's say my father-in-law, Roosevelt, ran a WWE, and I done married my wife, right?
Right.
I'm having a meeting with everybody. Hey, man, I just took my last chair shot.
What?
Y'all kiss my ass.
No, he
can't. Chair shot's over.
You can't just sit there and be like, no, I'm good. Look, Triple H is still, he get his head banged in the limousines and get thrown through ropes and barricades. Like, you can't just, you can't just be like, yeah, I'm good. I'm through with that. Thanks. Like, no, what, really? Well, it's funny to me because I have to really wonder, like, how many wrestlers, like, in the past have really tried that, you know? Like, how many have, like, gotten to that high point and was like, okay, I'm one of your top guys, right? So let me tell you what I'm not going to do. Like, no more tables. We're definitely not doing that. I will not be getting hit with any sledgehammers, bats, or kendo sticks. Like, we're just, no. Mm-mm. And you can forget about that. Oh, and definitely no more any level of chair shots or stairs. Thank you. Mm-mm. But the best you can do is throw me through a barricade, and that's it. We're not, just not doing that. And no slams on the concrete. Like, no slams on the concrete. Nope. Mm-mm. Matter of fact, don't even slam me on the apron. Just make sure only time that I take slams and bumps is in the ring with no kind of objects. Just, we're not doing it. No. Like, how many times has that really just passed? Like, it was, like, any execs in the wrestling world was like, yeah, okay, yeah, we got you. You're good. Like, what? No. Like, wait, what? Mm-mm. Mm-mm. You gotta take a chair shot, like, every once in a while. Just, no. Right. I mean, one or two won't hurt, will it? Like,
yeah, well, that's exactly what they would do. They would. But
okay, let me
before
stop.
We go off the deep end. So the New Day may have figured out the League of Nations, man. Like they after that beatdown Monday, they got the best of them on Raw and on SmackDown and on Raw this week. They know how to keep the numbers game down quick enough for whoever to get the win and get that pinfall.
Right.
We'll see how it all works out at WrestleMania. As far as I know, it's not for the tag titles at WrestleMania. And I guess it's going to be 4-on-3 in the tag match. We'll see how that works out.
Yeah.
But other than that, who knew Fandango was still in the league?
Look, I'm going to tell you how shocked I was about that. So I really was just kind of like, where the hell has Fandango been? Like, I seriously was just in awe that they even said his name. I was like, who? I'm like, wait, he still wrestles? Like, I swear to you, Keith, I did not expect that. I was so thrown by that. I just couldn't even. I had to rewind it for a second. Like, I was watching it. I was like, let me rewind this real quick. Did he just say Fandango? Like this show.
He won a match at WrestleMania?
Yeah.
Like, I forget all about that. Like, yeah, he did beat Jericho at WrestleMania. It's like, oh, that's right. Y'all didn't do nothing with him.
Right. Exactly.
Like, when he was that hot, nothing came from it.
Nope, they just let it fizzle and die. It was like, really? Like, so he's hot and y'all just put the fire out. That's really what happened with him. He got big and everybody loved him and they did dance and all that and then just don't. And it was just, now it's sad because now it's to this point where you see him and you're like, wait, he still exists? Like, I mean, I know he's a person and he's still alive and everything, but like, he still wrestles? Like here? Like, he's still on the roster? Like, wait a minute. Because he hasn't.
Everybody was Fandangoing?
Yeah! But he hasn't been in NXT or anything. So everybody was just kind of like, I know personally, I was like, Fandango? Where you been at? Like, hello? Like, can you address the crowd or something? Like, what the? Please, make a speech. Get on the mic. Like, can we talk about this? No, we're not going to do that? Okay. I'm not equipped for these kinds of things. Like, I like surprises. I do. I am all up for surprises and things that you just don't expect. Perfectly happy with that. But when in these kind of situations, it's like, I'm going to really need you to give some kind of update on this person or something so that no one questions where this person is or, you know, are they still on the roster? Do they still have a job? Like, what?
Yeah, man. I was like, is he still in the league?
Right.
Like, he ain't wrestled in like 2 years. Like, I mean, he might have been at house shows or something, but damn, man. Like, you got to get him on Superstars or something.
The crazy part about it is I didn't even hear about him at house shows. I read stuff all the time about, like, stuff that happens at house shows, you know? Like, because that's all. I follow a lot of wrestling fans on Facebook and stuff. So I hear about stuff that happens at house shows all the time, and his name has not came up. And I don't know how long. And I'm just kind of like, so where has he been? Like, has he been on vacation? Has he been just sitting at home? Like, what has he been doing? Can somebody please just enlighten me? Like, where has Fandango been? I just, no, you can't pull people out of thin air like that. Like, no. Seriously? It's one thing when you do the Del Rio route and you're like, you leave. And then, like, we know you're wrestling somewhere else. Like, we know this is happening. And then you come back and, you know, all that. That's different. That's totally different story. This is not the case. Like, man, they all just disappeared off the face of the earth and then just came back. And everybody was kind of like, dude. Like, have you just been traveling around with them this whole time? Like, what have you been doing? Has he been doing behind-the-scenes work? I just need to know, like, where has he been, really? Because no one just stays on the... Well, I take that back. Yes, they do. Let me stop lying. Okay. I was going to say no one just stays on the main roster and just is just not mentioned, but it's been too many times. It has been too many times where I have found out, and you too, Keith, that there have been wrestlers on the main roster that just ain't in the spotlight or just ain't out there, and they're still there. Like, they're on the active roster, but they just don't do anything. And it's like, why? I digress. Anyway, I still love Fandango, though. I mean, he looked great. I give him that. He looks fabulous. Like, he ain't missed a step. I can't say much about it, so... Yeah, he looked pretty awesome out there in the ring. Obviously, he's been working out, so can't say much about that.
No, I will completely agree with you. The guy's in incredible shape, and I just, damn, still in the league.
Right.
We went over the Undertaker stipulation, so pretty much if he, or have we not went over the Undertaker stipulation? Yeah, if he don't win at WrestleMania, just because we did go over it, if he don't win at WrestleMania, his career's over. A lot of people look at this like, oh, he can't lose then, because he can't end his career like that.
Right.
I don't know if he ends his career with 2 WrestleMania losses either, Keish. I mean, that's a big thing, too. Like, 22-1 right now is a good number. 23-1 might be better. 22-2... I mean, it's a hell of an achievement to get 20 WrestleManias. Let's get 20 WrestleMania victories will never be accomplished.
Nah.
I mean, you'd have to start today. Like, first of all, I don't even know anybody who has an active streak at WrestleMania. Then you got to survive all the years.
Right. Exactly. Exactly. You know, so, I mean, granted... Yes, you can skip a WrestleMania here and there, but it can't be like 3 consecutive WrestleManias. Like, it can't be anything that ridiculous. To do what he did, yeah, I don't think it'll ever be done again. I personally know. Like, I don't think that'll ever be done again. Just, nah, not at all. Because it just takes too much. Like, it really does. Yeah, you would have to start, like, matter of fact, in my personal opinion, you would have to have started, like, 5 years ago. Like, I mean, I'm just saying. And you would seriously have to have made sure that you won every single WrestleMania match you were in. You would have to make sure that you had a spot in WrestleMania, because it's been it, lately the trend is, you know, you're in, you can main event WrestleMania this year and not even be on the card next year. Like, you, it, I mean, it happens, man. Like, I don't know what to tell you, you know. So, I mean, 1 minute you got a match, and the next minute, you know, you're on the pre-show. Like, I don't know what to tell you. It's like, you just got to make sure that you can even get there first and then and stay there and actually be there for the 20 years. And then you have to win every match. Like, it's funny how it doesn't sound like it could be complicated, but at the same time, for anybody else, it is complicated. Like, it is that complicated, and it can always get worse. So, yeah. More power to the person that tries it, but I'm telling you, I don't know about that.
With that all being said, Keisha, I think it's time for our break.
Of course.
Because, yeah, man, we've been going hard. And we'll come back on the other end and finish up and talk some news and notes. And I get some ideas from Keisha that I didn't get to talk to her about last week's show. And we'll be back.
The 5 foot assassin with the roughneck business. I float like gravity, never had a cavity. Got more rhymes than the one that's got family. No need to sweat Arsenio to gain some type of fame. No shame in my game, cause I always be the same. Styles upon styles upon styles is what I have. You wanna diss the Phife, but you still don't know the half. I sport New Balance sneakers to avoid a narrow path. Messing around with this to catch the size of the. I never have stuff, cause I'm not a half stepper. Drink a lot of soda, so they call me Dr. Pepper. Refuse to compete with BS competition. Your name is special, so won't you suckle with the mission? I never walk the streets, think it's all about me. Even though deep in my heart, it really could be. I just try my best to like go all out. Some might even say, yo, shorty, black, you're bugging out.
Zulu Nation, mother's last creation.
Alright, on the back, on the flip side of the show, it is the birthday segment.
Birthday!
You will get this show March 24th, and do you, Keish, the birthdays, man, what day? I guess God was like, I need to make wrestlers.
Right.
Jack Swagger, March 24th, will celebrate his 34th birthday. Christopher Daniels will turn 45. On the 24th, which is today. Lana of Lana and Rusev fame will turn 31 on this wonderful Friday, March 24th. Jobber extraordinaire Barry Horowitz, can I give myself a pat on the back, will turn 56 on this day. But Keish, that is the most notorious birthday of all of them.
Mm-hmm.
Is The Undertaker. The Undertaker turns 51
mm-hmm.
on March 24th, Friday. Happy birthday, Taker. Keish, we've talked about WrestleMania. We talked about everything. Have you seen the video of him lifting 500 pounds?
No.
Yeah,
oh,
man.
Jesus, no.
He out here crushing it at 50.
Yeah.
Keish, I hope to be able to lift 300.
Keish, I'm telling
you. 500 pounds?
Right.
Shit.
At 50, please. I'm kind of a weakling, right? I get close. I eat about 75, but like, look. Just no. That's just not. So for him to be 50, listed 500, yeah, he got it. He got it. Woo! I'm telling you. He outdoing some 25-year-olds out here.
He outdoing most of society. Listen, I don't even need to, like, qualify with anything. He outdoing most living human people.
Right. He that person that goes into the gym, like a regular gym, and everybody looking at him like,
Like, when is he gonna stop adding plates? You done been at the, like, the Y stuff, or you done been at Planet Fitness, like, this nigga's still picking up plates.
Yeah. Yes. Yes, I have. I have been at any gym and looked and almost fell off a treadmill because I'm sitting here watching this dude continuously put plates. And I'm like, is he done yet? Like, seriously? Can he fit any more on there? That's the question. Like, who's spotting him? Who's spotting him? Like, is there anybody that's going to be there to catch this dude if these things fall? Like, you can't look at those kind of people too long, because I'm telling you, if you do, you end up hurting yourself. Like, because you're going to stare. You're going to stare. And they know you're staring. That's why they do it. They just throw it. Just keep doing it. Just, and you're looking like, really? Really, dude? For real? Don't let them have friends either. They just don't. All that just becomes too much. You just sit there. You're just like, okay, all y'all need to just stop. I've actually seen, and this is where this gets messed up. I've seen a picture on Facebook of a sign that was put up in Planet Fitness like, hey, so that no one else feels bad. Like, this is me paraphrasing. So no one else feels bad, please limit how much weight you put on your barbells and everything else to like 100 pounds. Thank you. Wait, really?
Oh, no. Planet Fitness is really jacked up in that way.
Yeah.
Like, Planet Fitness is one reason why I have to find somewhere else to work out, because, like, they don't want no grunting. They don't want nobody really... Like, it's a one thing when people, like, encourage each other and talk and whatever. Nah, man. They try to be... Well, we're not really a gym. We're Planet Fitness. I came for a damn gym.
Exactly. My thing is, their slogan and what they advertise off of, and I'm surprised they haven't been sued for this yet, but what they advertise off of is there are no judgment zones. You're a no judgment zone, but yet that's all you do. All you do is judge. Because if you didn't, you wouldn't tell people not to grunt and to limit how much weight they put on barbells. And, you know, like, you wouldn't tell people not to do the things that they normally do when they're at a gym. So I'm going to really need for you to decide. Like,
well,
are you going to judge or are you not? Like,
No, it's marketed towards people who are out of shape, right?
Right.
And they want you to come there and just basically give your money to them every month. They know you're not really going to be committed. You probably ain't going to work out that much. So there's not a lot of overhead. And you just come in there and dick around for a little bit and feel good about right. yourself. Because you're around other fatty bit fats. And, okay, now I'm judging you being an asshole. But no, seriously, that's all it is. Like when I be there, I don't feel inspired. Man, I feel good at Planet Fitness. I'm like, yeah, I might be the most in shape dude in here with my gut. But that's what you do, because it's like, yo, look, everybody's there because real gyms made them feel bad. Look, no. Like, after I joined, I was like, man, no wonder this shit only costs $10.
I'm telling you, Keith, speaking as a person that had a Planet Fitness membership for an entire year and went all of like 10 times, I hated it. Like, I didn't enjoy Planet Fitness just for the simple fact that I would get in there and I would work out. But, like, I felt like most of the people around me, regardless of how big or small they were, most of the people around me were doing half of what I was doing. Like, I saw this girl one time that on the treadmill next to me, she looked like she could be all of like 150. And I swear to you, she was walking slower than I was. Mind you, when I on that treadmill, I fitness walk. So I'm at like a good 3.5, almost 4, right? I'm practically running. She's just walking like at a 2 and just chilling. Like, what? That's Planet Fitness for you. Like, if everybody don't look like you, they're doing half the work you're doing. And then if you do more than they do, then they're just looking at you like, so you really came in here to work out? Like, it's like, are you serious? Well, we're not a gym. Well, I'm gonna need y'all to act like a gym with all this gym equipment. Like, this is ridiculous. I can't.
But Now that we really taking the show down. Cause, I was just like, look, this is some bullshit. But let's bring it back home. Let's talk about this wrestling.
Please.
I got news and notes. Keith, so did we talk about Hulk Hogan and the Gawker lawsuit? Was it last time he was here?
No.
Because you know he won, right?
Yes, he did. And it was for, like, I think the estimated that he amount that he won for, if I'm correct, was like $125 million or like $145 million.
It comes out to about $140 million. He won $115 million in the initial settlement. Then he got another $26 million in punitive damages.
Jeez.
Most notable from the trial, of course, is this wonderful sound bite that I want to play now.
Okay. Did you hear the discussion about the length of your penis? Did you hear?
Yeah, that? I heard a lot of it. I don't know if I heard the whole thing because I couldn't understand everything, but I did hear numbers talked. I heard 2/3, and I compared it to hands and feet and figure it out. I heard that part.
Do you, let me ask you this, just let's see if we can simplify this. Do you have any doubt as you sit in that witness stand today that you were discussing the length of your penis on Bubba's radio program? Any doubt?
Well, it's not mine, because mine isn't that size, but we were discussing the length of Hulk Hogan's.
Seriously? So... You
no, seriously, I do not have a 10-inch penis. No, I do not. Okay. Seriously.
Fair enough. So what you're telling us is you were discussing
believe
Hulk
that,
Hogan's
seriously.
Penis, right?
Excuse me?
You were discussing Hulk Hogan's penis.
Yeah, because Terry Bollea's penis is not 10 inches like you're trying to say.
All right. Now, I take it when that discussion was being had over the radio in this community, you didn't think that was invasive of your privacy, right?
My privacy?
Yes.
Terry Bollea?
Or Hulk Hogan?
We've talked about Hulk Hogan several times. I need to make you understand this, that Hulk Hogan gave up his privacy the moment he walked out his front door, became a celebrity in anonymity.
Right.
And so I don't like talking about Hulk Hogan's penis, but I've already... tried to explain to you, I gave up my right as Hulk Hogan to have Hulk Hogan have any privacy. Okay. I don't know how much clearer I can make that to you.
All right.
I'll do whatever I can to help you, but I just don't know whatever else to say to make you understand that.
Fair enough. So you're doing the best you can, right?
To help you, yes, sir.
Okay. Now, shortly after you appear.
So yeah, apparently... we learned the penis size of Hulk Hogan and how it is different from Terry Bollea.
Yeah, I don't even know all that. Thanks. I'm good not knowing that much.
Well, here's the thing. The reason they did that is because what Gawker was trying to establish is that he openly talked about his sex life. Therefore, he's a public figure who's a sex figure, I guess. It is okay to publish a tape of him having sex while lying. This actually is a landmark case for some case. I explained this last week because this is right to privacy versus First Amendment.
Right.
Yeah, right to privacy won. So it was a lot of weird things because people was cheering for him, but even though they still despise him because also that Gawker trial broke everybody's heart because that's what the one that told us that Hulk Hogan was kind of racist.
Yeah. Yeah, it was.
So.
And I have been, I know about the winnings of the settlement because I have been watching him. Today I watched him on The View. I didn't see him on Good Morning America, but I did see him on The View. And he has literally been just doing interviews now, you know, after the fact, giving his side of like why he sued and like what it meant. And, like, why? Because I think one of the questions that were asked was, like, how was this different from, like, every other, like, star that sued because of a released sex tape? And in his own words, he pretty much was like, well, they knew they were being filmed. I didn't know that I was being filmed. Like, that's pretty much the difference. Like, that's the big difference is... they had full knowledge that they were being filmed. Like, they agreed to, like, have this happen. I did it. I didn't know I was being filmed. I had no clue that this was even happening. And then, bam, it's just out there. You know?
Yeah, so, I think the big thing with that was, even if he knew, he didn't know it was going to be released to the public, right?
Right.
And that's the thing. And then Gawker had it, and they had no right to take that film and distribute it without his consent and not give him no bread or nothing, right?
No.
So this is going to be a big blow to the Gotcha website, to trying to, you know, expose people or exploit people. Like, I think this is going to be... I don't know if Gawker got $115 million, to be honest with you.
He probably doesn't, and that's probably why he's appealing. That's probably exactly why he's appealing. Like, they're going to go through a big appealment fight because of all of this, but I can understand it. Like, if somebody told me I owe somebody $140 million, like, I would appeal too. But, yeah, like, it's going to get... I'm not going to say it's going to get ugly. It's just going to be a long-dated process. But, yeah, like... I actually been keeping up with this since it was first, put out there. And I actually can understand why he won, you know, because I'm pretty sure there are still people out there like, you know, well, it doesn't take back what he said and this, that, and third. And I understand that too. I'm not saying that, you know, we're just going to disregard all that. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is, I understand, like, just think about it if it was you. You're at your friend's house, and y'all do something incredibly stupid and outlandish and just downright degrading, almost. And then, like, because this was, like, what, a few years later? All of a sudden... Bam, the whole world sees it. It's out on YouTube, it's on Instagram, it's on Snapchat, Facebook, whatever else is out there for this platform, for this to be seen on. I'm pretty sure you sue too. Because you had no knowledge that you were being filmed. You had no knowledge this was even being recorded. And then now the whole world sees it. The whole world knows this. The whole world has access to it for the rest of your life. Like... Yeah, right. You know, of course you'll sue. You'll do something. Like, no one in their right mind is just going to sit back and be like, nah, I'm not. Well, it's out there now. You know, fuck it. It's not going to happen. Like, just don't even sit there and tell a lie. It ain't going to happen. Now, for the amount that he won, Jesus. like, that's all I can really say about it. Like, man.
But here's the thing. How much can you put on personal privacy? I don't know if there's a price for that.
There's no price for it. No, there is also, no price for it.
I would argue that it cost him a lot of money, because in an era where the WWE is trying to produce a PG product, they can't have the man at the head of a sex tape scandal going out repping the company.
Exactly. I mean, so, it cost him... I want to say everything, you know, like everything that he had going on at that moment that was released just vanished.
Yeah. They probably still could have had something, but Gawker also tried to damage his reputation during the lawsuit, which they did. And I mean, he helped him by releasing the part of the tape where he might have called people niggers, but you know, neither here nor there. Hey, dude won. I let him have it. There's a punishment that would have killed Gawker. I looked up, does Gawker have $115 million?
But, of course,
but you know, I gotta find out. But I just keep talking about Hogan awarded the money. But it doesn't really, because you can get awarded anything. The Goldman family got awarded a shit ton of money in the OJ lawsuit.
Right.
But yeah, it just all this is like basically, hey man, it'll kill Gawker. But they don't really say, cause hey man, what they gonna do?
Right.
They can't. But they got it. I don't know if it kill him, cause hey man, y'all gotta earn this bread.
Right.
Y'all shut down. Y'all better pump out some articles.
Exactly. It's funny because it literally might take like one good tape or like one good article or just like that one good thing that could make him all this money. Get away.
There's no one article that can make that. But hey, I'll say this. Glad I don't work for
him. Right.
This sound, people gonna start getting some pay cuts.
Whoo boy, what? It's going to be some changes around that office.
Right. Like, you got to bring in your old coffee for now.
That's no longer in the budget. Sorry.
Yeah, we do not have. We got a Keurig set up, but you got to bring in your old K-Cups. Like, we not supporting that shit. We shut the office down at 6 because we got to cut all the lights off. Because we got to save on the electricity bill. Also, if you come in after 8 o'clock, we will not be running the actual lights in the building.
Exactly.
We're gonna open up all the blinds and let the sun come in. We're going to tell you, it's going to be bad over at golf. Just understand. But that's neither here nor there. Let's get back to these wrestling news and notes, man. So, I touched on it earlier, but I guess I'll get back to it. Luke Harper appears to be injured. He may have a torn ACL.
Man.
Hey, man. The roster's suffering.
Yeah.
So is wrestling, right? Just understand, I don't know if there's been a 100% healthy time in wrestling. Like, there's always somebody out for something.
Right.
Sami Callihan is joining Lucha Underground for season 3. You remember Sami Callihan from the Independence, worked a lot for Dragon Gate and Evolve. Also, which I think he works for Evolve now, which is kind of interesting because he was over at NXT. And I'll touch on that later because that Evolve relationship with WWE, I think it's a good way for WWE to kind of stash talent where, hey, let's say you fall out of NXT like Chris Hero or whatever, right? And you work it over at Evolve. Hey, man, if you start doing the things they like to see you do, they'll bring you back. I think TNA better watch. Like, if I was TNA, first of all, but TNA ain't got the bread to be making demands on people.
Right.
I tell Drew Galloway, my new champ, hey, man, you can't work in Evolve no more. Because you don't think he wrestles there and people like Triple H and William Regal watch like, oh, hey, guy looks good. Wow, he's really fired up. He's showing a lot of stuff he wasn't showing when he was working for us.
Right.
I'll monitor it. Okay. Hey, that TNA contract coming up towards the end?
Hey. Right.
We need some bread. Trust me. I'm sure they can pay double what TNA paying. And it don't even sweat. You know what I mean? Because TNA, I mean, they ain't breaking a lot of bread. Pop TV can't be. I don't even know if they paying them. So, you know, this is a company that try to film all the shows in one day at the same place. Gotta believe kind of that they, you know what I mean, ain't paying Galloway that. The fact that he working Evolve shows on the side, yeah, they probably ain't paying that much. But neither here nor there. What else is going on? I'm going through the notes. Let's see, I got the Gawker thing. New York State legalized mixed martial arts. They are about 100 years behind the curve, but okay.
Right. Wait a minute. I find it more funny because New York, it's illegal to have guns in New York. So it's like, wait, you're just now legalizing mixed martial arts? Like, what?
No, you understand. Like, It's not have guns in the state. It's illegal to have guns in the city.
Okay.
Now,
but still, like.
Yeah. Now, but no, as far as MMA goes, like, this is a state law because the state athletic commission has to sanction it. But, yeah, man, they missed a lot of money. Because you talk about having, like, a MSG, UFC show. It's a lot of bread in that. And, you know, it takes people a while to get money. And I'm sure, like, New York, because it's still a heavy boxing state, and boxing is incredibly popular in New York. Like, it's still, like, next to none, like, huge in New York. It's not as big as it is in some other places, like, as it used to be, but in New York, they still love their boxing. That's just, I mean, it's, they appreciate the science of boxing in New York. But I'm sure those boxing commissions have a lot of power. They probably kept MMA off the radar in New York for a while. But, hey, man, somebody's pockets couldn't get ignored. So they was like, hey, we got to get this thing, dude. I need this bread to steal.
Exactly.
You know that's how I feel good at work. Like, people got to steal all the money. But that's it for news and notes. The rest of the show, man, we got a few minutes left. Just going to talk some things out. Keish, here last week. We talked about, I just talked about Drew Galloway being a new TNA champ. That's one of the new developments of TNA. They released Bobby Roode and Eric Young. Now, they didn't release them they fired them, but they were granted their release. Which I think they're both tired and fed up, and they just don't know what else to do next. Keish, can this company survive?
It's looking like it won't. Like, personally, I just think it's starting to die slowly. TNA, I give them credit for holding on and trying to survive. You know, I do give TNA credit for putting up a good fight, because there's always a possibility of a turnaround. You know, you don't ever feel like you're just down and out. It's like, no, I'm not giving up. We're just not doing this, you know? So I give TNA credit for that. But at the same time, I feel like they really are starting to die slowly. Like, it's just kind of being drug out. And I don't think at this point that TNA is going to survive this. Because when your top stars start one by one by one, In a somewhat rapid, I wouldn't call it, let me not use the word rapid, in a somewhat fast pace, because to me that's a little, I'm curving it a little bit. Like, I just feel like at that point is when you're starting to lose. Want to see, yeah, TNA, but it's been happening. It's been happening, and slowly we start to see their stars just show up in other places. Because if they're not in the indies, they're not going on to WWE. You know, if they're not somewhere off, you know, in like ROH or New Japan, or just pretty much in just indie shows, period, they're just starting to, they're actually starting to sign contracts to be on NXT, you know, somewhere, or just to even work out. It's starting to happen more often because they're not getting what they need from TNA. And I don't know if TNA at this point can even provide it. You know, when your stars, when your top stars, people that have been loyal to you since day one, have started to be like, hey, I'm done with this, you know. I need you to go ahead and just let me go so that I can explore better, more and better options. Then that's when it's like, okay, maybe this is it for us. But TNA just don't seem like the type, well, I'm not going to say they don't seem. TNA to me is not the type of company that's just going to throw in the towel. They're not just going to just disappear off of TV one day and just like, okay, we're done. Like, you're going to know when TNA is finished, you know? Like, you're going to know when TNA has been like, okay, this is it for us, you know? But they're not giving up. They're not giving up. And who knows? I mean, like, they try. And I give it to them. TNA is trying every level of their hardest to keep it going, you know, to keep the company going, to just keep it alive. And I think at this point that they're done. They just haven't really wanted to say the words yet, you know? Like, they're holding on. And I'm not saying they should just let go. You know, if they want to put up the fight, hey, more power to them. I mean, that's what some indie companies do anyway, ain't it? You know, especially the ones that are alive in, like, their own individual states and stuff. But this is different. This is a totally different situation. And I just don't know where they can go from here. Like, I really don't.
I'll say this. I'm a little bit more optimistic than you, right? Me and one of my coworkers was talking about this the other day. They like the cockroaches of wrestling.
Oh, Lord.
Like, you can't get rid of them. Everything that should have been a death blow was not. Okay. Getting kicked off the spike should have been it. Lights out, right?
Right.
They found Destination America, which totally miscast fit, but we gave it a shot, right? Because I thought Destination America was trying to rebrand their network. Because I was like, it don't fit in with all the barbecue shows and shit, but maybe they'll do something with it, right?
Right.
Because that's all I know Destination America to be is, because I had it when I had AT&T. They were like, hey, man, we going to find the world's greatest barbecue across country. This is how you make barbecue sauce. That's all the show was about. But they decided to go wrestling. And then they doubled down on wrestling. They brought in ROH. And then let both of them go like, this ain't working. I think they thought they could try to create some new crossover viewership, but they didn't really think it through.
Right.
Other than that, like Pop TV, they got bad luck. Hey, I had Pop TV the first week TNA came on, right?
Right.
They moved it out my cable package. Like, yo, y'all don't want nobody to watch this. Or did y'all think that y'all could get more money? You know what I mean? Like, oh, well, I guess I could probably say, you know, if people really want to watch this channel now that we got this wrestling, people will pay for it and add extra money. No.
Exactly.
Like, that was probably Destination America. I was like, that's okay. Look, man, I didn't up my package for Lucha Underground. I just was watching. I just watched it a day late. Look, I'm not adding no more money to this cable bill. They already breaking my arm.
Exactly.
They lucky I can't get Google Fiber out here, because I wouldn't have cable. I would just have that bad internet, and bad being good, and I would be trying to find channels that way. I had Netflix or Hulu.
Right. Look, all I'm saying is just, TNA gets every bit of my appreciation and applause. Okay, I like I said before, I actually am impressed by the fight they're putting up to keep the company going. Like, I'm never going to discredit them for that. You know, I just don't know how long and much longer they're going to survive. Like, I have to honestly say, in my opinion, it's just questionable.
I say this, they're not afraid to scale back.
No, not at all.
They're not afraid to scale back at all.
Not at all.
You know, they'll run that operation bare bones, and they don't really care about, and I don't, here's the thing, they don't draw enough to tour. The TV tapings really don't, I don't know, it's like they're so far behind, and they don't know how to freshen it up. I mean, because, like, not that they're behind, because NXT, like, the NXT you watch is probably like a couple of weeks old, but it don't feel that way.
Right.
TNA, it already feel old. Like, you feel like, like, I watch ROH, and when I watch the ROH shows, they come on, and, hey, man, ROH come on network TV here.
come on Saturday, 9 o'clock. Then they reshow it at like 12 o'clock in the afternoon on Sunday. So if you miss it, you catch it again. I watch it, I'm like, oh. Even though I know they a little bit behind, I know stuff that's already happened. I know other people don't work there no more. Whatever. I'm good. I'm watching like, yeah. This is some good wrestling. I don't know. I don't catch on with TNA like that no more. I think I'm frustrated with them at the most part of it.
Right.
Other than that, Stan Hansen finally got announced for the Hall of Fame. So the Hall of Fame class is rounded out. Now, there is a possible for a celebrity induction this year.
Of course.
And word on the street, it might be Snoop Dogg.
What?
Word on the street. And the induction will be done by his first cousin, the boss, Sasha Banks.
Wait. Time out. Because now I'm just getting hit with bricks. Come on, Keith. Stop playing on me. Banks is Snoop's cousin?
Yes, that is a thing. Yes, she is his first cousin.
First cousin, like
parents are siblings.
Ah, cousin. Man, what? Nobody ever tell me this before. Like, I swear I'll be the last to learn stuff. Like, for real, yeah. Man.
That's like a thing. Which I don't know if that's on the same side of the family as Brandy and Ray J, but you know.
Right.
Yeah, she's related to Snoop. So that's the thing. Also a change in the induction. Kevin Von Erich was going to induct the Freebirds into the Hall of Fame. I think that's been scrapped, and now the New Day is going to do it. Okay, here's the thing. I get having the New Day do it because they use the Freebird rule, right?
Right.
But Kevin Von Erich is the last living Von Erich, Keish. He's already a Hall of Famer. And it's in Dallas. If it wasn't in Dallas, I don't know. To me, the purpose of inducting them in Dallas is you're inducting them in the place that is most resonates the most with the Freebirds, right?
Right.
This is the place that really took the Freebirds into a national phenomenon is Dallas with the Von Erich feud. Who else better than Kevin Von Erich to launch that off and to explain the history of what's going on and to get that big pop from the Dallas crowd who so loved Von Erichs? But here's the thing. It's finally stuck in. I listened to Jim Cornette talk about this Thursday. And it was an older show that he did with Mick, like maybe like 2 weeks ago. But I just listened to it last week. It's the WWE Hall of Fame. It's not a wrestling Hall of Fame. And what I mean by that is that Drew Carey is in the WWE Hall of Fame. Lou Thesz is not in the WWE Hall of Fame. I don't think you can have a credible professional wrestling Hall of Fame without Lou Thesz or Carl Gotch being in the Hall of Fame. If you don't know who some of these people are, I will just Google. But like, you have to know your history and these kind of things. Certain people may never get in. Midnight Express may never get in, right?
Right.
Which, if you know anything about the 80s and 90s, there's no way the Midnight Express or the Rock and Roll Express should not be in the Hall of Fame already. But all this goes at one man's discretion. His name is Vince McMahon. And, you know, these things will be awarded later to Triple H. And when Triple H is in charge, it may lean a little more towards a wrestler Hall of Fame, but as of right now, it is a WWE Hall of Fame that will honor and exemplify people that Vince likes. Vince doesn't. It's all really because they had ideas of building a physical Hall of Fame, and that got scrapped.
Right.
At least for now, it's really a money grab, right? What they do, it's another chance to sell some put some TV time on because they got to honor these big TV contracts. So, or they're going to put it on the network, one or the other. So, get on the network. And it's just to get a cheap pop the night before WrestleMania. Jim Cornette broke down a cap criteria. Like, you got somebody from one of the eras, the Golden Era or the Attitude Era. Then you have somebody who is local to get that local feel. Then you have somebody who they probably about to put a DVD out on or something like that.
Right.
And, you know, somebody who can sell some tapes. Hence, when they did divide Eric's in the World Class DVD was coming out. Also, they was in Texas. Stan Hansen this year, they in Texas. That makes sense. You get somebody really Texas. The Freebirds, the Freebird Rule, where they'll probably do a Freebird DVD or something like that. You're always one minority. You induct a woman. And then you do the celebrity pop. Right?
Right.
So, all the criteria is met this year. Jacqueline covers woman and minority because she's black and she's a woman. If you go down the line, Hanson is local. The Freebirds, they cover Dallas. You know what I'm saying? So when you start looking around, it makes sense. But at the same time, I think they would be better served if they worked a little harder and tried to, like I said, make it a more credible wrestling Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
But they chose not to do that. And that's fine, because it's Vince's company.
Right.
I would tell people to look at, like, Cauliflower Alley Clubs, their Hall of Fame. Pro Wrestling Observer Hall of Fame. Dave Meltzer and his crew, because they really do a good job. But other than that, man, you know, my personal favorite, the WrestleCast Hall of Fame.
Of course.
I mean, I don't know, man. I thought about doing a Ring Time Pro Wrestling Hall of Fame.
Just, hey, man, why not?
Who better, right? But that's where I'm at with that. I think what happens is they're the gatekeepers of wrestling in WWE right now, and people expect more out of them. But Vince basically just when he decided he wanted to do wrestling, he do wrestling. When he decided he wanted to be entertainment, he be entertainment.
Right.
But hey, man, that's the show this week. I hope y'all enjoyed it. We did a longer show than I thought, because I didn't realize. I thought we didn't have a lot, but apparently we do.
Hey, that's how it always be.
But we'll catch y'all on the other end. Peace.
Bye.
Want some, but see, I create sounds that make your ears go numb. Peace to share, zap, yeah, you know how we go. My best friend Steven at the Home Depot. Gloratin is in the house, I can't forget Southside. Walk past some seas like that girl did the far side. I'm labeled as the catch me out, the MC with the know-how. Act like you know, not now, but right now. Beast of the East on them seas, I have a feast. I'd eat that ass like quiche, crack a smile like Shanice. Shit, I Jamaica scene, Jamaica Queens, but you can find me out in Georgia or anywhere in between. Now, if my partners don't look good, Malik won't look good. If Malik don't look good, the Quest won't look good. If the Quest don't look good, the Queens won't look good. But since the sounds are universal, New York won't look good. Pitch a fight, losing a battle, come on, get off it. Put down the microphone, son, surrender forfeit. Did I hear something about a crew? What they wanna do, you better call Mr. Babyface so he can bring out the cool in you. Or it'll be a sad love song being sung by Tony Braxton. And I'll dissect you like a fraction. Or you wanna be top cat MCs, I'll pop you like a zit. You wanna be the champion, more like Chief some shit. Big up myself every time when it comes to this. MCs be running scared as if they watching The Exorcist. I kick more game than a crackhead from Hempstead. My style's a milk, man, you think that I was breastfed. You know the Steeler when the Dicky Dog is on the scene. I dedicate this to all the MCs out of Queens. That goes for Onyx, LL, Run DMC, Akinelli, Nasty Nas, and the Extra P. We be the trotting up and down, man, there ain't no other. Enough respect to all my beefs that made the album cover. Yo, Tip, don't worry none, you know I get the party jumping. Get on the mic and break them off a little something. Yo, Tip, don't worry none, you know I get the party jumping. Get on the mic, my man, and break them off a little something. Ooh, la, la, la.